So shall we close our eyes and look unto our Father in heaven. Loving Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord Jesus, for your presence in our midst. We bow down before you, we worship you. Lord, your name alone be exalted. Lord, we want to humble ourselves to the utmost and be a zero before you, Lord, so that you can be everything in us, in our lives, in our family, in our fellowship. Yes, Lord, your name be exalted. We want to decrease and we want you to increase. And Lord, cleanse us with your blood and flood our hearts with your Holy Spirit. Help us to experience the true freedom that comes through your word. Deliver us, Father, and Lord, set us free in all aspects. The truth shall set you free, that is what you have promised. And Lord, we want to experience the fullness of that freedom in our lives more and more progressively. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that you are going to do that. And your name alone be exalted. In Jesus' precious, sweetest name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, we've been seeing the glory of the Lord in the mirror of the Word of God in Hebrews. And we were seeing how the book of Hebrews portrays our blessed Savior, Lord Jesus, is a forerunner, somebody who has run ahead of us, who is a perfect example for us. He is a perfect high priest. We saw, we were in Hebrews chapter 8 last week also, and we were seeing that the great burden that the author of the book of Hebrews had is to introduce to the Jewish believers the superiority of the new covenant, how blessed and how far superior the new covenant is than the old covenant. Just as Jesus is above Moses, like that the new covenant is above the old covenant. Moses was just a creation, Jesus is the creator, and by his precious blood this new covenant was established. And we can come to a greater spiritual height than any Old Testament saint have ever experienced. Jesus himself says that in Matthew chapter 11, if we keep a finger here in Hebrews chapter 8 and go to Matthew chapter 11, there Jesus says about John the Baptist being the greatest among those who have been born of women. Matthew chapter 11, verse 11. Matthew 11:11. Easy to remember the reference. Truly I say to you, Jesus says, among those born of women, there has not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. One who is in the kingdom of heaven, of course, a person who is in the kingdom of heaven has been born of women, but he has been born of the Holy Spirit also. So among those who are born of women only, that is the old covenant people, John the Baptist is greatest, even greater than Moses and Elijah and Job and Daniel. And John the Baptist was the greatest among all the old covenant saints, those who are born of women. The new covenant saint, a truly born again child of God, is born of, not only born of women, but also born of the Holy Spirit also. We have been born from above. And we can rise to a greater spiritual height. We have the potential to rise to a greater spiritual height than any Old Covenant saint have ever experienced. Because in the Old Testament, the most holy place had been blocked. There was a thick curtain. And direct fellowship and union with God was not possible in a fuller sense in the Old Testament. Even Moses used to speak to God face to face. We read in Exodus 33:11. There were many men in the Old Testament also who had a New Testament spirit, who really longed after the fellowship of the Lord. They had a longing after God. But actually, only when Jesus died on the cross, only when Jesus became the perfect sacrifice for our sins could be cleansed. In the Old Testament, the sins could only be covered. Psalm 32:1, how blessed is the man whose sins and transgressions are covered. But now 1 John 1:7 says that if we are in the light as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. We are not only, it is not like in the Old Testament, the example that I've heard is that in the Old Testament their sins were covered. That means just like if all our sins were written on a blackboard and there was a, somebody will come and put a blanket over that, long piece of cloth over that, so that the sins would be covered and nobody would be seeing that. So of course we have they had a temporary assurance that their sins are being covered by the blood of bulls and goats. But there was an annual reminder in the same book of Hebrews which we are dealing with. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 3 says about, but in those sacrifices in the Old Testament, there is a reminder of sins year after year. Annually there was a reminder of sins year after year. And verse 4, for it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. The blood of bulls and goats could only cover the sins temporarily. But Jesus' perfect sacrifice on the cross, we can be the blameless Lamb of God has been sacrificed on the cross. And now the blood of Jesus can cleanse our hearts and when Jesus died on the cross, that veil of the temple at Jerusalem was torn from top to bottom, indicating that we have an access to the most holy place. In other words, God ministered to people in the Old Testament only in the bodily and soulish realm. We are spirit, soul and body. We all know that verse, 1 Thessalonians 5:23. So the spirit, in our spirit, we were dead in our trespasses and transgressions. Ephesians 2:1 says that we were dead in our trespasses and transgressions. Not in our body we were dead, not in our soul we were dead. Because, even unbelievers, they are very healthy, more healthier than many believers. So in their body they are not dead. In their soul, many unbelievers are having more sharper intelligence and cleverness, which are the soulish faculties. So they are not dead in that soul also. But what is dead in an unbeliever is the spirit. The spirit was dead. When Jesus' blood was shed, and when we repent and entrust our lives to the Lord, the blood of Christ can cleanse our heart. That means cleanse our spirit, cleanse our conscience, which is a part of our spirit. And the guilt is taken away. There is no condemnation. And we have the Holy Spirit has now come to our dead spirit and made our spirit a new spirit. And that new spirit is the new man, or the inner man, or the new self that the Bible is talking about. 2 Corinthians 4:16, Paul says, my inner man is renewed day by day, although the outer man is decaying. So that inner man, that is that spirit which has been created in the created after the image of God through the Holy Spirit, has to be renewed and transformed from one degree of glory to another to become more and more like Christ. And we were seeing that. So in the Old Testament, in that spirit realm, they couldn't experience the fullness of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came upon people, just like the classic example that Brother Zach says, if a glass is covered with a lid and water falls on that, nothing goes inside the glass, but there will be the water flows, overflows and blesses other people, but the inside of the cup will remain filthy. That lid is the veil that was broken, that was torn on the cross. Now, because that veil has been torn, we can surrender. When we surrender ourselves, when we surrender our self-will to the Lord, in our willpower, which is denoted by the golden altar, then we surrender ourselves. Even when we become born again also, there is an act of surrender. Faith is trusting or entrusting or surrendering. So repent and believe. Through repentance and faith only born again experience happens. So we are believing. So we are repenting, meaning turning away from ourselves and the world and the flesh and everything, and we are turning towards the Lord and surrendering ourselves to the Lord, where there is an act of surrendering of our will even when we become born again, the first step of our salvation. When we surrender ourselves to the Lord, our will is yielded there, and of course there was a small tearing of that veil that happened when we became born again, so that the Holy Spirit could enter and give us life in the Spirit. And if we surrender ourselves wholeheartedly, that time itself we will experience a fullness of the Holy Spirit. But the more we surrender, as the Lord gives us more and more light, more and more of that veil will be torn, and more of that empowerment of the Holy Spirit happens in our life, and the more we will be transformed into Jesus' image, and the more this rock of the self-will or the veil of that self-will is torn, the more that rock of that self-will is hit and broken, more that shell of that kernel of wheat is broken, more the life would come inside that Holy come inside the Spirit through the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. And the more we will be blessed in our own personal life through the fruit of the Holy Spirit, and through the gifts of the Holy Spirit, we can be a blessing to others also. The rivers of living water will gradually and progressively flow from our innermost being to bless others. In the Old Testament, the flowing of the Holy Spirit from the innermost being was not there. That is what we read in John 7:37 to 39. John 7:37, Jesus says on the last day of the Passover, Jesus cried out with a loud voice. John 7:37. Now on the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scriptures say, from his innermost being will flow rivers of living water." For this he spoke of the Holy Spirit, whom those who believed in his name were to receive. For the Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Then we will wonder, Spirit was given in the Old Testament also. Old Testament also we read that the Holy Spirit came upon David and Samson. But actually when we read that verse in that context, as we have heard Brother Zach explaining very simply, what is implied over there is that the Spirit was not yet given in this way. In what way? As flowing from the innermost being. The innermost being is a Spirit. So that was blocked in the Old Testament, because the veil was not yet torn. With Jesus' death, the veil was torn, and the access to the most holy place, access to the Spirit is there. And the Holy Spirit now has access to a Spirit through the death and sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. And when we believe in that sacrifice and death and surrender ourselves to the Lord, the Holy Spirit can come inside our spirit. And the more we surrender ourselves totally in various circumstances, and the more the Lord is able to crush our self-will through different trials and failures and difficulties in our life, the more the power of the Holy Spirit will be able to bestow upon us and inside us, so that the rivers of living water will be flowing from the innermost being. That was not possible till that time. It was verse 39 we just read. So coming back to Hebrews chapter 8, we were seeing last week also that we have got a more excellent ministry. Verse 6, Hebrews chapter 8, we saw that Jesus was appointed as his son. The son himself is appointed as the high priest. Chapter 7 verse 28, and he was made perfect forever. And we saw that Jesus was not that he was, of course, as God he was always perfect. He is and he was and is and always will be perfect. But when he came as a man, when he emptied himself and came as a man, he had to be made perfect. And he was made perfect through suffering in the flesh. We already saw that in Hebrews chapter 5 verse 7 and 8 and 9, verse 9, Hebrews 5:9, having been made perfect. That means actually he learned submission and obedience through the things which he suffered in the flesh. Verse 8, Hebrews 5:8, when he surrendered himself as a little child, as a young boy, as a adolescent, as a young man, when he surrendered himself totally to the Father, he learned obedience or submission. The Greek word for submission, obedience, is one and the same, hupakao. And he learned that submission in the things which he suffered. He suffered in the flesh. It means he died to his own self-will. Flesh is self-will. Suffered. What he suffered is not just the external sufferings, whether it was external sufferings or inner sufferings, he died to himself. When there was external sufferings, the injuries or people talking bad about him, mistreating him, and inner sufferings where he was tempted in all points as we are, he died to himself. He suffered in the flesh and he surrendered himself, and the Holy Spirit was all the more poured out on him, and he grew up in wisdom and stature. We already saw that in Luke chapter 2 verse 40 and verse 52. 52 and 53, and like that Jesus was made perfect. And so that is what we read, Hebrews 7:28, the law appoints men as high priests who are weak, but the word of the oath, the word of the oath is Psalm 110:4, I have sworn, that is quoted in verse 21 there, the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. And this word of the oath, which came after the law through David in the Psalms, appoints a son, that is the Lord Jesus, made perfect forever. And we are also called to walk, pressing on to perfection along this new and living way, along this way of the cross. New and living way, and the way of the cross is what we read in Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 19 and 20 says about this new and living way, pressing on to perfection. Hebrews 6:1, we read there, after saying about being made perfect in Hebrews 5:9, Hebrews 6:1 says about pressing on to maturity or pressing on to that perfection. And we saw that Hebrews chapter 8, we saw that verse 1, the main point is that Jesus, the high priest, we have such a high priest, he has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of majesty in the heavens, and he is a minister. Although he is a king and a priest, he is a minister, he is a servant. He came to minister to people. Not to be ministered, but to minister. Not to be served, but to serve. We saw that Jesus' own words from Mark's Gospel, and how he humbled himself like a bond slave, and how he ministered to people. And he's a minister in the sanctuary, that is in the most holy place. Hagios is that pronunciation. Sanctuary, holy place, most holy place. He's a minister there, and that true tabernacle, the true most holy place, is in the third heaven, the very presence of God, where there is a fullness of joy. That symbol and or shadow or copy of that tabernacle only Moses was building, because Moses was asked to build according to the pattern which was shown to him on the mountain. Verse 5 says that. And this true tabernacle, verse 2, was pitched by the Lord himself, not man. And every high priest is appointed to offer both gifts and sacrifices. If Jesus was on earth, he would not be a priest at all, since there are those who offer gifts according to the law. But those people who offer gifts according to the law serve a copy and shadow of the heavenly things. And that copy and shadow, that reference to that is what we already saw last week from Exodus chapter 25 verse 40. And Exodus chapter 26 verse 30, where Moses is told that you make all things according to the pattern which was shown you on the mountain. On the mountain, God showed him the pattern of the true tabernacle in heaven, and according to that pattern you build this. Like that Moses was instructed, and Jesus is the high priest in this, the real tabernacle, the true tabernacle, not just the copy or shadow of the tabernacle as the Old Testament saints are, Old Testament Levite priests way ministering, but Jesus is the minister in the true sanctuary, which is in the third heaven itself. He is the king over there, and he is the priest also, he intercedes as a high priest. He is interceding for us day and night. Hebrews 7:25, we saw that verse already. And verse 6, Hebrews chapter 8 verse 6, But now Jesus has obtained a more excellent ministry, and we were seeing how from 2 Corinthians 3 in detail last week, we were seeing how far great, I myself was so, encouraged to expound on that chapter, 2 Corinthians 3, how the New Covenant ministry is so far greater and glorious. And, as New Covenant children of God, when we minister His word to other people, when we live a life full of rest and peace, we know that our adequacy, our sufficiency is from God Himself. As we already saw that in 2 Corinthians 3 verse 5, our adequacy, our sufficiency is from God. And this is a ministry of righteousness, not of condemnation. In the Old Testament, the letter kills, the spirit gives life, 2 Corinthians 3, 6. And there was condemnation in the Old Testament, there was fading glory. Here there is righteousness, ministry of righteousness. There is glory is increasing from glory to another, one degree of glory to another. Verse 18, 2 Corinthians 3, 18. And such a freedom and such a liberty, because where there is a Holy Spirit, there is liberty. 2 Corinthians 3, 17. And so this is a more excellent ministry. Because we have this excellent ministry, we do not lose heart, is what 2 Corinthians 4, 1 says. After saying about being transformed, if we turn for a moment to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, when we behold the glory of the Lord in an unveiled face, that means when the veil, when the self-will is broken, the veil is taken away when we turn to the Lord. Verse 16, 2 Corinthians 3, 16 says, and when the self-will is broken, the Holy Spirit comes and fills our heart, fills our spirit, and we'll be seeing the glory of the Lord in the most holy place, in the mirror of the Word of God. And that we were seeing that that word beholding as in a mirror, that word beholding is a Greek word katapriso. It is a combination of three words actually, kata, optonomai and isoptron. And what that means is, it has got two meanings. One is see oneself in a mirror, that is beholding the glory of the Lord. And the second meaning is that to reflect in a mirror. In Malayalam Bible, the word pradibimbikunu or reflecting in a mirror is used. In the English Bibles, most other translations which I was seeing, the word beholding the glory. So both are the meanings of the verse actually. So we should understand both that shades of that meaning. That is, very wonderful. Like when we behold the glory of the Lord in the mirror, the more we behold the glory of the Lord, the more we will be reflecting His glory. Just like the moon reflects the light of the sun, we do not have any original glory. Our glory is a reflected glory. Our glory is from the Lord. And just like moon doesn't have any original light, it is reflecting the light of the sun. Like that, our adequacy is from the Lord, 2 Corinthians 3, 5. And we are beholding when our self-will is broken, and when we are filled with the Holy Spirit, in the spirit realm, in the most holy place, we are beholding the glory of the Lord. We are seeing the, when those who are blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God, Matthew 5, 8. When we are filled with the Holy Spirit can enlighten our hearts to see the glory of the Lord, which cannot be described in words, but something of the glory of the character of Jesus Christ. Our eyes would be open to see that Jesus' life is the most wonderful life that has been ever lived on the face of the earth. And we'll be challenged more and more to become like Jesus, to have a deeper fellowship and communion with the Lord. And that real New Testament ministry comes from that beholding and reflecting. That is what we read here. But we all with an unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord. And of course, there another shade of meaning of that word is that reflecting, beholding as in a mirror. The mirror is the word of God, James 1:23. And beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, and reflecting the glory of the Lord. And the more we behold the glory of the Lord, we are transformed into the same image of the Lord. How much we have been transformed. The word transformed actually is metamorpho. Metamorphosis, and we study in biology, the butterfly metamorphosis. meta and morphos. Morphos means form, and you know, changing that form. The same word is used in the Mount of Transfiguration, that Jesus transfigured on the mountain, Matthew 17:2 and Mark 9:2. The transfigured, that word is also metamorpho. So in one sense, we are in our spirit, although in Jesus, you know, on the Mount of Transfiguration, even his body, you know, there was a glorious body also the disciples saw. But what happens to us is actually our spirit is getting transformed from one degree of glory to another. So our spirit is transfigured, we can say. So just like Jesus was transfigured with that glory on the Mount of Transfiguration, our spirit, the more we see the glory of Christ, the more we see the humility and gentleness and selflessness and purity and you know, even strictness and zeal and passion of Christ, the more we will be reflecting that, the more we will be transformed into that, we will be transfigured to that glory. So beholding us in a mirror and transformed into the same image, that is what we read there in 1 John also, keeping a third finger, keeping a second finger there, going to 1 John 3. Many of you would be familiar with these verses, I know, but it's always good to see the verses also. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2 says that, what happens when Jesus comes back? Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, we will be like him. Oh, such a such a great thing, no? We will be like him. We will be like him totally. Sinless perfection when Jesus comes back. Because we will see him. Why we will be like him? Because we will see him just as he is. We will be seeing him just as he is. So now we are seeing him as in a mirror. 1 Corinthians 13:12 also, Paul is saying that when Jesus comes back, he will be seeing him directly. Now we are seeing us in a mirror. So we are seeing the glory of the Lord in the mirror of the Word of God. In the spirit we are seeing the glory. But now we have a foretaste. The fullness will come when Jesus comes back. And so we will be like him because we will be seeing him just as he is. From that verse also, what we understand is that the more we see him in our spirit, the more we will be like him. Of course, that sinless perfection happens when Jesus comes back and we'll be directly seeing him. But today, a foretaste we are experiencing in us in the spiritual realm, in our innermost being, in our spirit, the more we see him, the more we will be transformed and we will become like him. That is partaking of the divine nature that Peter speaks about in 2 Peter 1:3-4. All the promises are for this greatest promise of partaking of the divine nature. And so coming back to 2 Corinthians 3, transformed into the same image from glory to glory. You know, in the Moses face, verse 13 says end of that glory was fading away, so Moses had to put a veil. Two reasons for putting the veil for Moses: one, that people were not able to look at his face; another thing was that Moses didn't want the Israelites to see the end of that glory which was fading away. But today Moses could only be in the mountain for a few days. There, today, every day, every moment, we can enter this rest. We can be in this most holy place and behold the glory of the Lord 24/7. Even while we are asleep, we can be in communion with the Lord in our spirit, and we can behold the glory of the Lord. And there will be a transformation from glory to glory. That is what the same 2 Corinthians, after a few verses in chapter 4, verse 16, Paul says that my inner man is being renewed day by day. Paul was had such a such total surrender and brokenness that he could be transformed and renewed day by day. Every day, Lord expects us to be transformed and transfigured into the Lord's likeness, image from glory to glory, and justice from the Lord, the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the Lord who brings this ministry. As Brother Zach also says, this is the best verse in the Bible which explains the ministry of the Holy, the true primary ministry of the Holy Spirit, to show us the glory of the Lord and we will be convicted of our own sinfulness, we will be repenting and we will be surrendering, and the Holy Spirit empowers us to become like Him. The more we see the glory of the Lord, the more we will become like Him. And verse 4, chapter 4, verse 1, the next verse. Unfortunately, the chapter division comes, you know, sometimes actually they, in a very, we may miss something when we, you know, do not continue to read because of the chapter division. So, the next verse after this transformation, what does it say? Therefore, because we have, because we can be transformed from one degree of glory to another, and since we have this ministry of getting transformed from one degree of glory to another and experience a greater and greater freedom, as verse 17:3:17 says, through the Holy Spirit, as we received, so since we have this excellent ministry of, this excellent ministry is what we read in Hebrews chapter 8 verse 6, this excellent ministry of becoming like the Lord more and more, because we have this ministry, as we received mercy, because of the mercy of the Lord, not on our own merit, we do not lose heart. We are not disgraced because we become more and more like the Lord, and we do not lose heart. And he goes on to say about how the gospel is veiled to some people and all. And coming back to Hebrews chapter 8 verse 6. So the ministry comes out of the overflow of the life which fills the most holy place through beholding the glory of the Lord. The more we behold the glory of the Lord, the more the Holy Spirit fills us and transforms us to the Lord's likeness, and that life overflows through our words and our deeds and blesses others, and that is the ministry. Ministry is not just preaching the word of God, but whatever we say that can spiritually edify others becomes our ministry. Our life itself, the overflow of our life itself becomes our ministry. The life overflows. My cup overflows, the psalmist says in Psalm 23. And so Hebrew, coming back to Hebrews chapter 8 verse 6, now Jesus has obtained a more excellent ministry. Jesus has obtained, you know, Father gave him, and he obtained from the Father a more excellent ministry, by as much as he is also the mediator of a better covenant. So as we, you know, put the headings of some of our sessions, better covenant on better promises, so it comes here, better covenant, you know. And now that we have come to this far, we know that how, you know, the more we see the glory of Christ and how much we can be transformed and how much we can rise to spiritual heights, we'll understand that this is a far better covenant. We'll be really grateful to the Lord. Lord, thank you for giving me the privilege to live post Calvary so that I can experience this better covenant on better promises, which has been enacted on better promises. What are the better promises? Is enumerated subsequently in verse 9, 10 and 11. And the promise is actually the promise of entering the rest. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 1. And when we enter the rest, what all we will be experiencing in little more detail, the three terms of that covenant, new covenant, is has been prophesied by Jeremiah already in Jeremiah chapter 31:31. If you turn to Jeremiah 31:31, we'll be seeing exactly the same verse which are quoted over here, quoted over here in verse 8 onwards. So before that, verse 9, verse 7 is there. So better covenant, better promises. Better promises we'll be seeing. And verse 7 says, for if that first covenant, if the Old Testament, old covenant, which God gave to Israel through Moses, had been faultless, there would have been no occasion sought for a second. So there is not that, you know, God did some mistake by giving the first covenant. That is not the meaning of that. But it had a fault, because it could not make man perfect in his conscience. What the law could not do, God did by sending his own son. We saw that in Romans 8 verse 3. So the Lord could not make man obey the inner commandment. You know, Paul was struggling with the commandment, do not covet, Romans 7. And how God delivered him through the law of the Spirit of the life in Christ Jesus, Romans 8:2, we read that. And then Paul says that what the law could not do, the law could not help him to obey the commandment, do not covet. The inner commandment, that inner purity, that real partaking of the nature of Christ, that the law could not do. The law was just a set of rules and regulations, which was actually given for man to prove to him that you cannot by your own strength come to God's standards. Among the Ten Commandments, the tenth commandment, do not covet, is the inner commandment. All the other was external commandments. All the other externally, Paul was blameless according to the law, Philippians 3:6. But the inner commandment he could not keep, and he was honest to himself. Unlike the rich young ruler, Luke chapter 19, and all, if you read rich young ruler, Luke chapter 18. We read about the rich young ruler, or even in Matthew and Mark also, the rich young ruler we read about. He says to Jesus that, Jesus told him, testing him, obey the commandments. So he is saying that I have obeyed all the commandments from my childhood, but Jesus, what is listed over there, if you just turn to Luke chapter 18, verse 18 onwards, Luke 18:18. The rich young ruler questioned him, good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And you know the commandments. Jesus says, why do you call me good? Because God alone is good. Whatever goodness you see in me is from God, who is the source of all good. I am just a channel. Verse 19, because Jesus came as a man, although he is almighty eternal God, because he came as a man, Jesus is saying, verse 19, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness, honor your father and mother. So verse 21, he said, all these things I have kept from my youth. So, but if he was honest to himself, he would have told, Lord, all the commandments I have obeyed, but the 10th commandment I could not obey. But actually Jesus is pointing out to him the 10th commandment. He had a covetousness for money. So Jesus is telling, you are saying that you are kept from the youth, but verse 22, when Jesus heard this, he said to him, one thing you still lack, sell all that you possess. He didn't tell everyone to sell everything that they possess, but as Brother Zag also clearly explains, because his cancer of the love of money had spread so metastasis had occurred so badly, the spread of cancer was so bad that Jesus had to tell him that you had to sell all that. And but if he had come and bow down before the Lord, say that, Lord, I am not able to, please help me, Jesus would have of course helped him and delivered him. But he went away and he became very sad. Verse 23, because he was extremely rich, and Jesus is telling how hard it is for rich people to enter the kingdom of heaven. And also the 10th commandment, the rich young ruler was not honest to himself. He didn't acknowledge that. Jesus again pointed out that inner commandment, but he didn't humble himself to seek the Lord's help. But Paul was honest, although Paul was zealous according to the Jewish traditions and all, this commandment, do not covet, do not lust, in other words, in simpler words, do not lust. All types of lust was there, that was revealed to him. All type of lust he was struggling with, he says in Romans 7. But Paul had that struggle, and he would have been seeking God in earnestly. But externally he would be persecuting Christians, and that conscience pricked him. And then he was seeing the martyrdom of Stephen, and how he is praying to the Father in heaven, do not hold this sin against them. Acts chapter 7, the last portion. And Acts chapter 9, we read about the conversion of Saul to Paul. The prick of the conscience could speak to him, and it is hard for you to kick against the gods and all. Further, when Paul tells testimony, Paul is testifying there that how Jesus asked him, that how Jesus told him that it is hard for you to kick against the gods, that comes in actually Acts chapter 22, I think. Acts chapter 22 also he says that testimony, and also that phrase kick against the God, yeah, it is coming in Acts chapter 26 actually. Acts chapter 26 actually he is testifying, Paul is testifying verse 14. When we all had fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in Hebrew dialect, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the gods. So that is not, the kick against the gods is not a common expression that we use in English, and some people who are very fluent in, very well versed in English might know, but I mean that was a new word for me. What that means, I mean I have you know written down the dictionary meaning of that, something that pains as if by pricking thorn, that is the meaning, kicking against the gods. So there was a prick of that conscience in him, and it is hard for you to kick against the gods, you know, it is hard for you to you know kick against as if a thorn, it is always you know paining you, it is always pricking your conscience, like that God was saying him. And then Jesus, Paul was saying, who are you, Lord? And I am Jesus whom you are persecuting, verse 15, and we read there. And so how you know what I was trying to tell was that how Paul's honesty and that prick in that conscience, everything led him to humble himself before the Lord, and the Lord revealed himself to him. And so yeah, coming back, so yeah, so in that way the law had a fault, that the law could not make a man perfect in his conscience. We read that in Hebrews 9:9 also. Hebrews 9:9, the law is a symbol for the present time. Accordingly, the tabernacle is a symbol for the present time. Chapter 9, verse 9. Accordingly, both gifts and sacrifices are offered in the Old Testament, which cannot make the worshipper perfect in conscience. In other words, the Old Testament, the law could not make the worshipper perfect in conscience. In the New Testament, we can have a perfect conscience through the blood of Christ and through the Holy Spirit. We can have a perfect, blameless conscience. Paul is saying in 1 Corinthians 4:3 that I have nothing against myself. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3. But to me it is a very small thing that I may be examined by you or by any human court. In fact, I do not even examine myself, verse 4, for I am conscious of nothing against myself. I have a perfect conscience. And we all can have that. If we repent of whatever sins that we know of in our conscience, we can also have a perfect conscience. We will come to that in that verse, in that verse 12 of Hebrews 8. So, here, coming back to Hebrews chapter 8, verse 7. So, the law had a fault. So that is why there is an occasion for the for a second, that is a new covenant. And Hebrews chapter 8 verse 8, for finding fault with the children of Israel, God says, that is a quotation from Jeremiah 31:31 onwards, behold, days are coming, says the Lord, when I will effect a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. You know, there were two kingdoms there, house of Israel and house of Judah. We are the spiritual house of Israel and house of Judah. God wanted to establish that covenant with the people of Israel, but you know they rejected Jesus, the mediator of that new covenant. And now we have been we read that in John's gospel, he came to his own and his own rejected him, and whoever received him, God gave them authority, right to become children of God. John chapter 1 verse 11 and 12. So now we have become the spiritual descendants of Israel, spiritual descendants of Abraham. We are the spiritual Israel, and now this new covenant is with us. And verse 9 says, it is not like the covenant which I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. You know how the Lord is expressing that concern. I took them by the hand from the land of Egypt, you know, through Moses. God was actually literally taking them by hand from that destruction in Israel, from that, the chastisement that fell upon the Egyptian people. God was leading them by hand And but they did not continue. God gave them a covenant through Moses. We read that in Exodus chapter 3, when God is telling Moses to take his people out of the land of Egypt. That all covenant, a covenant was given to Moses, and you know, they did not continue in my covenant, is what verse 9 says, and I did not care for them, says the Lord, because they did not continue in the covenant, I could not care for them. And then this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel, verse 10 and verse 11. Verse 10 says basically about God writing his laws in our heart, basically means the word becoming part of our spirit, and we become transformed from one degree of glory to another. We become partakers of the divine nature. We'll come to that in detail. And verse 11 says, knowing the Lord. When the more we become partakers of the divine nature, the more we become like the Lord, the more we'll know the Lord, and we'll have a deeper fellowship with the Lord, deeper union and oneness and communion with the Lord. And verse 12 says, for I will be merciful to the iniquities. So I will be able to write my laws upon your heart, and nobody need to teach you to know the Lord, because I will be merciful. So in other words, although verse 10, 11 and 12 are given in that order, verse 12 is the first term of the covenant. You know, covenant, there is terms and conditions, no? So the first term is actually verse 12, because it starts with the conjunction for, because I will be merciful to the iniquities and I will remember their sins no more. Because of that only I am able to write my laws upon them, and they will all know me, from the least to the greatest, they will all know me. So actually the first term of the covenant is verse 12. So verse 12 says, for I will be merciful to the iniquities and I will remember their sins no more. That is what we put that as the topic today. There is no condemnation. That is something, of course, that may sound very basic to many of us who have been believers for many years, but actually I've seen even believers who have been in the Lord for many years, but actually they will be having some condemnation in their heart, some guilt in their conscience, some people even lacking assurance of whether God has forgiven them, whether God is happy with them. That kind of that foundation is not that strong in their life. Actually verse 12 is actually the foundation, justification. That word justification comes in the book of Romans. That justification basically means justify. The Greek word means make righteous. So we are made righteous there. If you turn to Romans chapter 3, we read there, verse 23, we all know, Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus. So there is a redemption which is in Christ Jesus. Through that, by his grace, by the power of the Holy Spirit, as a gift, not as if something that we merited or deserve, as a gift, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we are justified. Again, we read in verse 26 that he would be, so that he would be just and justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. So justified by his grace through faith. And again, verse 28, we can underline that 24, 26 and 28. We maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. So the faith through grace. And if we come to chapter 5, Romans 5, verse 1, therefore having been justified by faith. Again, verse 9, there we read that much more than having been justified by his blood. So actually we have been justified by his blood, by his grace through faith. Actually justification, the forgiveness is the mercy of the Lord. And that grace is a larger term that includes mercy also. That is what we understand from Ephesians 1:7. Mercy denotes the forgiveness of our sins, that which denotes the past. Grace that which denotes the present and future needs of us. Ephesians 1:7, we read there that we have forgiveness. Ephesians 1:7, in Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of His grace. So, that forgiveness of our trespasses, which is actually mercy, that also is included in the riches of grace, but grace is much more than that. Mercy comes through the blood of Christ and grace comes through the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of Grace in Hebrews chapter 10 verse 29 and Zechariah chapter 12 verse 10. And so we have been justified by His grace, by His blood, through our faith in Christ. When we, that justification is something that happens as soon as we are born again. When we are born again, the Lord has declared us righteous. In other words, you know, what we read in Hebrews 8:12, I will remember your sins anymore. I will not remember your sins anymore. If we had truly repented of our sins and have set right things in our life, whatever the conscience pricks us, if the Lord tells us to forgive somebody, we forgive others, and we forgive everyone that we know, that we can think of in our conscience. We have nothing against anybody, and we have done restitution also, like Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus, he had had many unrighteous money, so he wanted to return that money with even with interest. So double the portion I'll give, four times I'll give, and half I'll give to the poor, because I do not know whom all I cheated. So half of that I'll give to the poor, then I'll give four times what I have taken. And so I mean, actually that restitution, whatever we have wrongfully taken and all, we are giving back so that we can have a clean conscience. So as soon as then repentance, which includes that reconciliation, that is asking forgiveness from those whom we are hurt. If somebody has something against us, we reconcile with that person, we apologize to that person. Matthew 5:24, we read that when we come to offer something before the Lord, even our prayer, whatever, everything of our life should be an offering before the Lord. And when we come before the Lord to pray, and there we remember that our brother or sister has something against us, we leave that offering there and go and first reconcile with your brother or sister, and then come and offer the offering. We all know that verse in Matthew chapter 5 verse 23 and 24. So that reconciliation and restitution, like Zacchaeus did, giving back what is due, that is all part of the repentance, where we turn from our own ways. Repentance includes restitution and reconciliation, and the blood of Christ cleanses us. And so when the blood of Christ cleanses us, God gives us a clean, perfect conscience, where we need not have any condemnation. We can be totally free of any condemnation. Even if we fall umpteen number of times in any sin, but if you truly turn away from that and say that, Lord, I do not want to sin anymore. Lord, I really want to please you. I do not want to sin even once, even in my innermost motives, Lord, I do not want to sin. If you are truly repented, the blood of Christ cleanses us and we are justified. Just as if we had never ever sinned, and just as if we have kept all of God's commandments, like Christ obeyed the commandments. You know, that liberty of justification is very very deep, actually. Some churches I've seen, actually they will be very majoring on this justification, some other churches will be majoring on the sanctification, but actually we should have the balance of the scriptures. Justification, what happens when we are born again, is justification, where we are made righteous, or God has given us a robe of righteousness, so that there is no guilt, or there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans 8:1. And sanctification is we becoming more and more like Christ, the transformation of our spirit that we mostly speak about in our meetings and all. And glorification is something that happens in the future. When Jesus comes back, we will be like Him, just as He is sinless perfection. Glorification, we will get a transformed body also, that will happen in the future. Justification, the past tense; sanctification, the present tense; and glorification, the future tense. 1 John 3:2, already we just saw glorification. We will become like Him completely, sinless perfection. So sanctification is a present day process, but justification is the foundation. Without the assurance of justification, we won't be able to stand before the throne of grace with confidence. Why we are able to stand before God with confidence? With our self-will, with our corrupt flesh in which nothing good dwells, how can we face God? Because God has cleansed us and covered us with the righteousness of Christ. All our own righteousness, self-righteousness was like filthy rags, Isaiah 64:6. And God has taken away all those filthy rags and has cleansed us and robed us with the robe of righteousness, just like the prodigal son who returned was given a brand new robe by the Father. We have been given the robe of righteousness of Christ, so that when the Father sees us, he is seeing Christ in us, and we are made complete in Christ. You know that verse in Colossians 2:10, it's a very blessed verse. We are complete in Christ. Colossians chapter, when we are really cleansed by the blood of Christ, when we are truly repented and when we are cleansed by the blood of Christ, what happens? We are justified, or God reckons us as complete in Christ. Colossians 2:10, for in him you have been made complete, and he is the head over all rule and authority. You can have a perfect conscience. He does not remember our sins anymore, because it is not only covered by the, you know, I was saying that in the Old Testament it was just covered by the blanket, but what happens in the New Testament is that Jesus comes there, and what he does is that he takes away the blanket, but before anybody sees our sins, he is coming with a dust or a wet piece of cloth and rubbing all our sins forever, so that it won't be remembered forever. It won't be remembered anymore. And you know, the same thing, Hebrews 8:12, what we read is repeated again in Hebrews 10:17 also. I will remember your sins. I will not remember your sins anymore. We can hear the Lord speaking to our hearts. Otherwise, always there will be a condemnation. One thing that the Lord spoke to me personally many years ago was from Song of Songs. You know, the liberty of justification which God ministered to my heart through this verse in Song of Songs. You know, especially as genuine believers who are seeking after holiness and righteousness and all, it is very easy for us to become, feel condemned and disheartened, because of course none of us are perfect, and you know, if we look to ourselves, of course there are umpteen number of faults. We are not called to look to ourselves at all. We are called to look unto the Lord, fix our inner eyes upon the Lord, the author and finisher of our salvation, author and finisher of our faith, Hebrews 12:1-2. And when we look unto the Lord, in his light we see light, Psalms 36:9. And the Lord shows us in our conscience what has to be set right, even restitution and reconciliation, not to condemn ourselves in any way, but whatever the God shows us in our conscience, depending on the Lord, we do that, and the Lord will help us. Sometimes it might be very difficult for us to, you know, God knows what is possible, and he knows our heart and our genuineness, and God can give us a perfect conscience. And I was saying about this Song of Songs chapter 4 verse 7 is what the bridegroom says to the bride, or what the Lord says to each one of us. You are altogether beautiful, my darling. There is no blemish in you. Many a time we feel that, oh, we have so much blemish and we feel very guilty and disheartened. But actually, if we can really hear our heavenly bridegroom saying to us, my son, my daughter, you are altogether beautiful and there is no blemish in you. There is nothing unchristlike in you. Why? Because he is seeing us with the righteousness of Christ, and he is seeing us in that future glory of the bride of Christ. You know, we see that blessed verse in Revelation chapter 21. He is the Alpha, Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, and he can see the end from the beginning. And he sees us as the bride of Christ, full of glory. That is what we read there, Revelation 21:10-11. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me the holy city Jerusalem coming out of the heaven from God, that is the bride of Christ, having the glory of God. Her brilliance was like a costly stone, as a stone of crystal clear jasper. So if the Lord can enlighten, if we humble ourselves, the Lord can, you know, God has hidden these things from the wise and intelligence and revealed them unto babes. Matthew 11:25. If we humble ourselves like a little child and say that, Lord, nothing good dwells in my flesh, Romans 7:18. And Lord, I believe that, I believe your word, which says that I have been justified, I have been made complete, there is no blemish in me, and you do not remember my sins anymore. And that is the real freedom, you know. The God is seeing us, Jesus is seeing us in that future glory. Oh, my son, my daughter, although we feel very unholy and very full of problems and weaknesses, the Lord is seeing us in that future glory and say that, oh, full of glory, having the glory of God, the heavenly Jerusalem, I am seeing no blemish in you, you are altogether beautiful, my darling. To redeem us pitiful sinners, and the Lord Jesus, the Prince of Heaven, came down, and we are made the Princess of Heaven, the Queen. We are made joint heirs with the Bridegroom as a Bride of Christ in Heaven. You know, we have been seated in the heavenly places. Ephesians 2:6 says, already we have been seated in the heavenly places. Spiritual realm, already God has placed us. And now we have to set our mind on things of the heaven. By, you know, Ephesians 2:6 says about our spirit being in the heavenly places. Colossians 3:2 says about our soul, which has to be set on the heavenly things by our surrender. And Revelation 3:21, when literally we will be sitting with the Lord on His throne in the heavenly places one day. There are body also, with the resurrected body, we will be sitting with the Lord in the heavenly places. And, you know, that is such a great salvation, such a, you know, the new covenant, the first term itself is such a liberating thing. And how much more the second and third term that we would be meditating in the further weeks, God willing. You know, that we need, you know, by the blood of Christ, we can have a clean conscience. And He has justified us, He has given us such a white garment of the robe of righteousness. And when we know that, you know, I've thought about this example. Suppose actually we have got very filthy clothes. Even if it becomes little more dirty also, we don't mind. Oh, anyway, it is already filthy, little more dirt, nothing much of a difference. But if you have a very perfect white garment, you'll be very careful that, you know, it shouldn't get stained. Many a time we as believers, we think that, oh, already we are sinners, even if one more sin, nothing, no, not much of a difference. But if we can see us as God sees us, for I've been cleansed by the blood of Christ, have a perfect conscience before the Lord, and no blame, Lord, you know, no stain of any sin, no blemish in me. And then we will be so careful that even in our thought or attitude, there should not be any stain when we are walking around in this world. And may the Lord open our eyes to see how glorious the liberty, the freedom that we can have from all condemnation and discouragement. Lord will help us. Lord will empower us. Looking forward to hearing from my dear. Shall we close in prayer? Loving, gracious Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord Jesus, for the Calvary. Thank you for shedding your blood. Thank you for giving us access to the most holy place in the spiritual realm, where we can enter into a restful life with you, where there is no condemnation, where there is no annual reminder of sins, because we have been cleansed by the blood of Christ. Yes, Lord, we want to repent thoroughly and radically at every point of time, so that, Lord, we can have a clean conscience before you, cleansed by the blood of Christ, to recognize that, Lord, we are complete in Christ, that there is no blemish in us when you see us, because we have been justified by faith through grace and through the blood of Christ. Thank you, Jesus, that, Lord, you do not remember our sins anymore. Thank you for your love. Thank you that your mercies are new every morning. And Lord, you are seeing as if we have never ever sinned, as if we have kept and obeyed all your commandments. Thank you, Jesus, for the confidence and boldness that we can have when we really know that, Lord, we have been really justified, made righteous, have been given the gifted, the robe of righteousness. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for this liberating word, and we want to experience the fullness of the new covenant in our life. Not only the justification and freedom from condemnation, but also partaking of your nature and knowing you deeper and deeper. Help us, Father. Help us to further understand your word in depth. Help us transform our lives as we behold your glory more and more through the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for our dear brothers and sisters. And Lord, we pray and bless the families that have been hearing the word of God. Bless them, Father, meet all their needs. And we pray for the pandemic that is raging across the world. And we pray that, Lord, you curtail it as soon as possible. And Lord, have mercy on the people. Let there be spirit of repentance more and more deeper in the church. And also, Lord, let many people come to know you through all this. Let your name be glorified, Father. We also want to humble ourselves and beseech your mercy so that, Lord, your work will be unhindered and that your glory will be revealed. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you for hearing and answering our prayers. In Jesus' precious, sweetest name we pray. Amen.